hear Jim like screaming now.
This week on Backward Compatible, Doc and Chris discuss the pros and cons of randomization in game systems design and how it can be used thoughtfully. Plus, Animal Crossing Pocket Camp, Vulgar, of Erthe and Axen Act 2, and more. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to episode number 114 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast. Games and new media with a splash of academia. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Doc.
Hi, everybody.
And unfortunately, Jim is out again today, but we have an interesting discussion for you. We're going to be talking about randomization in game design. Now, this is something that applies both to video games and to board games, or a third thing you could say is tabletop role-playing games, which is one of our areas of expertise.
And I'm going to throw card games in there too, because that is a form of randomization.
Absolutely, yeah. Basically, at what point do you introduce randomization into a design? What does that mean? What are the implications? Why wouldn't you introduce randomization in some cases? And what are kind of the pros and cons of doing so? So I think it's going to be a really good, deep discussion. We're going to get a little bit technical. We're getting a little academic.
Yeah, that's true.
But it's good stuff.
Yeah.
But first, we have some opening segments for you, including the gaming meta.
This is the gaming meta. News and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
So Nintendo recently held a Nintendo Mobile Direct to announce the new Animal Crossing game they're making for mobile. This is something that's been kind of in the works for a while. We've known it's been coming. Thus far, Nintendo on mobile has released Miitomo, which we've talked about before.
Right.
Fire Emblem Heroes, which we've talked about. And Super Mario Run, which we actually just talked about last week.
Yeah.
So I was very excited about Animal Crossing because, having been a fan of the series for many years now, I think that it works fine on consoles, but I think it's better on handhelds because it's supposed to be kind of like a daily check-in sort of gameplay style.
Yeah, I've always felt that way, actually.
Yeah.
Like, I've genuinely said in the past, that's a mobile game, right? No, it's for console. Oh. Mm-hmm. And been disappointed. I mean, I could see myself getting into it in mobile. So what did they announce? What did they say?
So what they announced, and so just to kind of preface this before I get into it, I was kind of hoping that what we would get is a like fully featured Animal Crossing. I wanted to basically be like, you know, the sequel to New Leaf or whatever the case might be,
which
is on the 3DS, just on mobile. Mm-hmm. And what we got actually isn't too far from that. So it's not a full-on Animal Crossing experience in the sense that you have your whole town and you've got a bunch of people with all the different houses and stuff like that. And you can kind of just like go around freely doing whatever.
Mm-hmm.
What they're doing is they're kind of keeping the full experience, but shrinking it into basically you're the owner, the manager, whatever the case might be, of a campground. And so there's a campground space that you have. They're going to be sort of furnishing and populating with all these different items the same way you might do with, say, your house in the main series Animal Crossing.
Oh, okay.
But it's also a bit of a public space. So you're going to have people, like characters in the game are going to be visiting and stuff like that. And also you can have visitors, like your friends that you've made on mobile, can come and visit your place. So you can go and check out other people's campgrounds. They can come and check out yours.
Sounds like a Facebook game from 2007.
It kind of has that vibe a little bit, but with an Animal Crossing spin.
Okay.
And in the same way, like, you know, speaking of like Farmville and those like that sort of thing.
I didn't say it. You did.
Exactly. They have this element of you like order a piece of furniture, for example, that you want to have made, and it's going to take, say, 72 hours to complete.
Oh, wow.
And then if you want, you can accelerate it by basically, they didn't call it bribing, but I like to call it bribing, paying extra, you know, bells or whatever, bucks. I forget what the
term is. Real money? Can you buy these with real money?
You can buy them with real money.
Oh, I see where this is going. But, yeah, it really does feel like Facebook.
But what's interesting is it reminded me actually in a lot of ways of the monetization in Fire Emblem Heroes, because they have these orbs that you can collect, and that's how you summon heroes for that game.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's different because that's not on a timer in the same way and a lot of other differences. But if they handle it the same way that they handle it in Fire Emblem Heroes, I actually kind of feel like a lot of times Nintendo's monetization's like not worth it. I don't find myself compelled to spend a lot of money, because when I do, and maybe Animal Crossing will be different because you can have tangible results like queues done like that, you get instant gratification. Whereas in Fire Emblem, it's like I have a chance of getting what I want when I pay money. Mm-hmm. So there's a difference there.
Okay.
To be sure. But at the same time, anytime I've spent money in Fire Emblem, I'm always like, oh, I shouldn't have spent that money. I should just go ahead and earn the orbs organically. And so you can earn the stuff in game. And you can do it in a number of different ways. Like, for example, like doing little requests for people. You gather the materials that they're looking for, and then they'll give you a little reward. And sometimes that reward might be these little bells or bucks or whatever it was. I forget exactly. And so that's kind of like the way it becomes the mobile game in terms of monetization. But I'm optimistic that Nintendo's going to handle it in kind of a classy way. And honestly, like, I don't mind waiting for stuff like that. You know, it's like one of those things for, I'm only on like once a day anyway.
Right.
And so it's like, oh, cool, I'll just log in tomorrow or 2 days from now and it'll be done. Great. And so sort of getting back to what I meant, though, by it being sort of fully featured but shrunk down, in addition to the sort of public space that you're building, you also have a like a camper that it's kind of like the equivalent of your house. And so it's like a smaller house.
Like a Winnebago?
Yeah, kind of something like that.
Okay.
Actually,
or is it a double wide?
It's more like a van almost. That's what it looks like from the outside.
Oh. As in, hey, you want to see the back of my van?
No, not quite.
Okay.
It's like somewhere between like a Winnebago and a van.
Oh, thank goodness. Okay. It's more like the Mystery Machine.
But you can furnish it the same way you could furnish your house in Animal Crossing. And it's got the same sort of deal where you can take out a loan to, you know, get the camper in the first place. And then you can also upgrade it. So like you can get like a second story on it, essentially.
Double decker van.
And so when we saw that, like, because my Nick and I were watching it, mm-hmm. and we were both a little bit concerned when we were first seeing it. It's like, oh, this isn't feeling like Animal Crossing. But they started exploring all the other things you could do. You can visit an island to hunt bugs and fish. And they actually added some efficiencies there that are kind of nice. Mm-hmm. For example, you can spend like one of your special tickets or whatever to get a fishing net that will catch you a whole bunch of fish at once instead of having to sit there and fish for them individually like you would typically.
Yeah, okay.
So they save you a little bit of time there if you're willing to spend that resource on it. But then like when we saw the camper and we saw some of the other locations, it's like, okay, this is starting to feel like Animal Crossing again, just on a smaller scale. Like literally like the camper has a smaller space than your house would in Animal Crossing. Mm-hmm. And so you're not gonna be able to furnish it with as much, but you can still have that sort of customization. So it seems like it's going in an interesting direction. I'm actually pretty optimistic about it. If you're interested in checking it out for yourself, the 15-minute Nintendo Direct is on YouTube, among other places, I'm sure. It's under the Nintendo Mobile channel as opposed to Nintendo. So keep that in mind when you're searching. But yeah, Animal Crossing Pocket Camp. I'm very, very interested to see how it goes. I'm definitely going to give it a shot.
I'm very optimistic for what Nintendo's going to do with their mobile space. I don't think they've gone crazy with it. I think they're still experimenting a little, but you know, Nintendo's very experimental. Mm-hmm. And given the possibilities that exist with the Switch, I think once it becomes more available, mm-hmm. I think we're going to see a lot of cool innovation in that area. You know, for the very first time in a long time, I really felt like my Switch playing has been very Nintendo-y. Mm-hmm. Because I've been playing lots of new games and new types of things. I talked about Death Squared last time and that kind of thing. And some of the stuff from Tomorrow Corporation a few weeks ago. And I actually pulled it off so that I was holding it like a phone and just forgot that I wasn't playing on my phone. Mm-hmm. And yet it was still very Nintendo-y. And so it's fun. You know, I'm optimistic.
It's time for War Stories, tales of tribulation and triumph in gaming.
So we've talked a lot about Witcher 3 on the podcast, mostly because it's a fantastic game that deserves to be talked about. They did a really great job with the story, the design, the art, all of these things. But I have found a thing that they did not do a very good job on, and maybe it was of no fault of their own. After winning all these awards and being amazing and having all this great DLC that was this great side missions and all of that, and becoming Game of the Year in however many terrible different ways there is you can become that, the all-in-one Master Game of the Year disc that you can get my dad had it. And it's funny, I've never actually bought this game. First, I borrowed Jim's for like a year, and then I gave it back. And then I borrowed my dad's copy, which he finally finished after playing for a year. Mm-hmm. And so now I brought it with me, and I'm like plugging it in, and I'm going, woo, I can pick up my game where I left off. Only one problem. It didn't read the save files. Mm. So whenever I had the basic disc and I played up through, let's call it halfway through the game, then got the more advanced disc and put that in, the advanced disc save file, or the advanced disc install would not read the save file from the other version. You tracking with me here?
Mm-hmm.
I had to start the game over.
So
I almost didn't play it at all because I really did not want to go through that first half of the game again. But I decided I would give it a try, and I am not a repeat gamer. I don't beat games and then play them again. There's like a short list I could list on one hand of games I have actually played all the way through more than once.
Mm-hmm.
And BioShock is on that list. It's at the top of that list. But apparently, I think that Witcher 3 holds up, because not only did I, over the course of about a week, play through all that same content again, but I played it slightly differently and really, really enjoyed it. I felt like my version of Geralt was a more pure and true version of my version of Geralt.
Mm-hmm.
I've said on the podcast before in the past that I've reloaded saves with Geralt so that I didn't make certain decisions due to explicit content and things like that accidentally surprised me. And in this case, I knew it was coming, and so I just avoided it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And to that end, I was able to do things like avoid fights that I didn't want to fight, and I tried to do a no-human kill run. Basically, yeah, these guys are guards. They're jerks. They don't deserve to die, though.
Interesting.
They literally, they're drunk or whatever. And so
anytime, so you just knock them out.
Well, either knock them out or run from the fight or whatever, right? So like there's an early on, when first town you get to, little tavern, these guys pick a fight with you.
Yeah.
I just walked literally walked away from it.
Mm-hmm.
Walked over, got on Roach, rode away, and then the fight was gone.
That's interesting because it's almost like a gamer psychology thing that we won't go into right now, that like when you go from the cutscene to the fight has begun, it almost feels like we're kind of compelled to fight.
To do it.
But it's like, well, wait, I could just turn around and walk away.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Well, okay, so here's the thing I did not expect.
Mm-hmm.
Later, much later in the game, whenever they shut down, what is it, like Skellige? Is that the name of the city?
I haven't actually played past that fight, okay. Basically.
So anyway, the big city, whatever it's called, they literally shut it down. So you can't get in. And I walk up to it, and they're like, pass. I don't have a pass. And this is not in the beginning of the game whenever you need a pass to get across the bridge. This is much later in the game when they've shut it down because the wizards have all left and that kind of, and the Inquisition is happening. This guard, random dude, walks up. He's like, he's with me.
Mm.
And I'm like, what's going on here? And he goes, listen, that night, whenever me and my buddies were picking on you, you really made an impression on me. You chose not to fight. Thank you.
Huh.
It was the dude I didn't kill.
That's awesome.
It was amazing.
You see, that's like the sort of thing we need more in these games with, story-driven
stuff. I know.
We talked all the time about, choice and consequence. And so this is something where, a choice that you made is reflected later in the game meaningfully.
And it was pretty much railroaded into, look, you're this awesome dude. Mm. You're going to kill these guys. They're picking a fight. They kind of deserve it. And you would never know. Never know that this is a thing unless, I would almost argue, unless you played it through twice.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
And that was, that to me, that's what New Game Plus should be.
Mm-hmm. Getting to play it a different way, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So to me, the whole thing was worth it.
Mm-hmm.
Playing, even though I didn't finish the first time because it was an abandoned save file and I restarted from the beginning, I'm now loving Witcher 3 again, and I'm really excited to get into the DLC and all of that that's coming, because I know it's coming. I've been told by everybody I have to play Blood and Wine. You got to play Blood and Wine. And I'm like, okay, fine, I'll play Blood and Wine, but I only had a level 20-something character, and now I finally got him back up to a point where, he's like 23 or 24 again, and I'm not going to start that until level 32, I think is the recommended.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know, something about it. I just kind of want to finish the main story as it was originally created and go find Siri and do the thing and then work on that, that DLC content. Cause another nice thing about that version is you can actually start a game file, where you just do that and you don't have to do the main story stuff,
which is probably the way I'd play it.
Yeah. And I was tempted to do that as well. Cause I was like, that main story didn't really do much for me, but, and what I found is that in this second playthrough, I have not focused as much on Witcher contracts as much as I have on the main storyline, and it's felt more meaningful. I haven't gotten distracted by that stuff because I've told you, and this is my guilty confession as a gamer, I over-level. And in this time, I didn't. Instead, I focused more on learning the spells, learning the about the oils, learning, you know, and actually instead of trusting on simply being overpowered, going, okay, this is a werewolf. I need to research werewolves and
cool.
doing it sort of the way I would argue it was intended.
Gotcha.
Or at least designed. And it's designed so well that you can just brute force it, but I haven't had to, and I've had a desire not to. So anyway, yeah, Witcher, if you never finished it, I recommend you go pick up the all-in-one version, add that to your collection forever and ever, and pick it up and play it again. It's worth it. It's a good game. It's going to last the test of time, I think. It
cool.
really is.
Very cool.
Believe it or not, we're not always playing games. Every now and then, we like to talk about the other stuff.
Okay, so this is a the other stuff double feature here. I'm going to try to quickly hit on a couple of different things. So
The other stuff.
So the first one I just wanted to share is this really cool tool that Nick actually shared with me a little while back called Vulgar. What Vulgar is a language generation tool. People in, you know, fantasy and people who are into role-playing and stuff like that will sometimes try their hand at conlangs, constructed languages.
Right.
Just languages they make up. Again, Tolkien's probably the most famous conlang designer ever. Or maybe not ever, but...
Well, you know, I'm not even sure that's accurate for him because he literally went into the etymology of it. And he was... I mean, he was a linguist. And so...
So he invented, like, the Elvish language and all these others.
And it was a genuine functioning language.
Exactly, so, yeah. So very dedicated people who do stuff like that. Other famous conlangs, things like in Star Trek, there's Klingon.
Well, there used to be, but then the Discovery came along. Yeah, that's my zinger. Not a fan.
In A Song of Ice and Fire, you've got High Valyrian, I think it is. And then, you know, other sort of fantasy worlds like that. And so based on these other properties that they like to do this, sometimes role players, among other people, will try to make their own languages. Turns out it's very difficult.
Yes.
And so what Vulgar does is I'm not sure if it's just a person or if it's a team of people. I think they're based out of Sydney, Australia. They apparently have this very deep understanding of linguistics and how language works, very like mechanically speaking. And so they ran a bunch of analysis on actual languages and made this generator that will actually create a new language for you, just like using a bunch of different random toggles and stuff like that, and then give you a dictionary of words, as well as some stuff about like how to pronounce them. Like they'll give you IPA readouts and stuff like that of here's how to pronounce this word. They'll tell you things about the sentence structure. So like, you know, do you have the adjective before or after the noun, is just as an example.
Right. As compared to say Spanish,
you'll hit a button and basically have a fully functioning made up language. Now sometimes there'll be, they'll make more sense to you than others, especially depending on your native language. And if you get into the full version, which I think is only like $10, it's super well worth it. Even if you don't even use it, I would just say, like, go support these guys because it's awesome.
I like to support awesome.
They you can get into specifying which phonemes you want to have in your language. And they keep adding new features constantly. Now that you can specify your sentence order, that sort of thing, your word order in sentences, I should say. And I actually at one point saw that they had a thing like, hey, if you have any feature suggestions, feel free to email us. And so I actually got in touch with the creator and was like, hey, I would love to have a tool that would let me take an existing language, or maybe like I think what I suggested specifically was I wanted to be able to say I know in the language that I'm wanting to generate, I want to have this word mean this thing. And could I somehow give you a set of words along those lines and have the language kind of generate from that?
Oh, that's a neat
idea. So it sounds similar. And so it's not exactly that same way, but basically what you can do now is take an existing language. You could even take English, for example, if you wanted to. Plug in the IPA for all this like bank of words, and the program will analyze all the words that you have in that bank and generate a language that follows that same phoneme pattern. So like the same, probability of a phoneme appearing and in certain combinations. And so Nick actually, as I said, introduced me to it, and he tried out just real quick. He didn't mess around with it too much, taking like a few pages from a book or something like that written in English. And apparently generated a language that sounded kind of like English. it's pretty cool what it can do. And if you ever wanted to sort of have a made up language for your RPG campaign or for a book you're writing or something like that, they don't like have any sort of copyright or anything like that on the language that's generated. So you could totally go and publish something with it if you wanted to. Another really cool feature that they came out with recently that I want to play around with more is basically an oxlang tool, auxiliary language. You can take a bunch of words, translate that word into a bunch of different languages, and it'll analyze that input to come up with the average word across those languages to basically give you an auxiliary language that's derived from all those.
Oh.
It's got so many cool features. It walks you through, if you want, like a guide to linguistics about how language works, how the program works. It's a super neat tool. Go support them. Vulgar. It's awesome.
Very neat. Well, you know, Thorny Games has something called Dialect.
Mm-hmm.
It's the RPG for that. So I'm wondering if you could use one for the other or the other for one, or if it would just like break both.
That would be interesting. I think it wouldn't fit in too well because Dialect is about creating words with specific meanings.
Yeah.
Whereas what Vulgar will do is kind of, it takes like the list of the top 2000 words in any given language and just sort of assigns a randomly generated
word
to
it. That makes sense. Yeah. So, like Dialect was on Kickstarter and other things. I think it was on BackerKit too. Build a language, build a word. Who were the isolation and how are they lost in this game? Your language is the story. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I backed it. Actually, I'm waiting for my copy to come in.
So. Excellent. Sounds like a roll with it to me.
Mm-hmm. The other thing I wanted to mention real quick is a few episodes back, I talked about Xanthochroid's album of Erthe and Axen Act 1. And a few weeks ago at the time that this is airing, they came out with Act 2, which is a really excellent album. For those of you who are amiable to cinematic black metal, it's one of the greats, I think. If you listen to the albums back to back, or at least in close proximity to each other, Act 1, in a very sort of narrative sense, I think I mentioned when I talked about Act 1, how I listened through it, and even without reading the lyrics or anything like that, got a sense of a story.
Mm-hmm.
That definitely happens in Act 2. If you put the two together, you get like this two-act structure where the setup in Act 1 is paid off in Act 2.
That's neat.
And so like it sort of concludes this story that's the prequel to their debut album and all this different stuff. Musically, it's much heavier. A lot of people sort of complained that there wasn't enough metal in this metal album that was Act 1.
Oh.
This one brings the metal. But it still has this really great mix of orchestration. There's like this ebb and flow of like really heavy, but then like something more somber, more, not laid back. But they take you through a range of tones. And one of the coolest moments in the album is at the very end. I think I forget if I mentioned this at one point, but if you look at the track list for the two acts, there are 8 songs in each one, and each title of the track, or each track title, is actually a line in a poem. And so you can read through the track list and basically get a poem.
Get the whole poem. Yeah, that's so cool.
At the very end of the last song in Act 2, that poem is basically used as a lyric. That's like
the whole poem is.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
I could actually confirm that they worked backward from that point. It wasn't just shoehorned in. It's like, hey, we're just going to do this cool thing. Isn't that clever? They actually built the album around this moment.
Yeah. Well, you've been in dialogue with them a lot.
Yeah.
Because of some of the creative things that we're working on together.
Mm-hmm.
And they're cool guys.
Oh yeah, they really are.
You want to talk about throwing money because, we support the awesome. Mm-hmm. This is a case. I mean, these are some genuinely cool dudes.
Yeah.
Had some weather problems. I mean, because they're down in Texas.
They put an announcement. They're indie. They basically have their own record label. They do all their own distribution.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Including physical shipping.
Which I super admire.
And so basically they had to delay sending out physical copies of CDs and stuff because their home got wiped out basically in the hurricane that hit in Florida. Yeah. And they didn't have a place for the delivery to be sent to or to send from. And so they had to establish a new address before they were able to ship stuff. So they had to, they put it off as long as possible, but they had to announce that, like, hey, so guys, sorry, this is the circumstance. We've been trying to figure out stuff and send everything out. But just like really genuinely good guys, like Doc said.
Yeah.
Definitely a good people worth supporting. Yeah. Like when that moment happened in that last song, like Nick and I listened to it together for the first time, each of us heard it, and we both just lost our minds because it was like when we realized what was happening, it was like, oh, they did it. They did it. And they, the whole track, I mean, they throughout the album bringing in motifs from Act One, even a few motifs from Act from their debut album, but it happens later in the chronology to kind of like foreshadow that, which is super cool musically. And then just like they have this really epic conclusion. Every time I hear it, I get goosebumps. It is
so
good.
That's cool. That's very cool.
And actually, I you know, you mentioned that I've been in contact with them. I'm happy to say that I was privileged to be able to work with them on the listening guides that they did for Act 1 and 2. Basically, Sam, who is the lead vocalist, and he does a bunch of other instruments too, wrote these as kind of like supplements to the lyrics. And I forget if I mentioned this last time, but it kind of explains the story that's going on, like the characters and the interactions and stuff like that. And so I helped out with sort of adding more of a writerly touch to them because they sort of, and Sam even said this himself, it kind of like skirts the line between like it dips into screenplay, but then it turns into prose, then it sort of turns into encyclopedia.
Right.
And it's kind of like a little bit of a mishmash. He's kind of just like putting together his thoughts. And so
it's like picking up the Cimmerillion and going, wait, where's the story?
Well, not quite like that.
No, it's not.
But basically what I did is I tried to make things a little bit more concise so you could read it without having to pause the music as often. I also sort of like, you know, cleaned up the more screenplay moments and just like made that prose descriptive. And so they all seem pretty happy with it. I was excited to work on it. So yeah, if you want to support my work too, technically, check out Xanthochroids of Erthe and Axen Act 1 and 2. At the time of recording, I don't think they've finished updating Act 1, or they haven't like released the update to Act 1. My edit of Act 2, though, got released with the album, and we're still going through a few final sort of revisions, iterations to finish polishing it, make it all pretty.
Awesome. But, I look forward to reading it.
Yeah, it was fun. It was really fun to work on.
Yeah. I love a good transmedia project.
Sometimes first impressions don't tell the whole story. Compassion linger, or is it doomed to burn brightly, then fade away? To find the answers, we ask, are you still playing?
All right, Chris, I'm going to call you on the carpet here.
This
is a big game, so this has to be a big question. Are you still playing Zelda Breath of the Wild?
Gotcha.
We all paid $500 to play this game.
It's true.
So so if you're not still playing it, you may not have gotten your money's worth. Just saying.
Right. So it's kind of a tricky question for me, and I feel like this happens a lot with the games that I get asked about.
That sounds like a no, guys.
Technically, I have not played it for a while. I still intend to get around to playing it.
Oh.
And so the thing is, I just haven't had a lot of time for gaming recently. And I've been finding that as awesome as Breath of the Wild is, I need to be in a very particular mood for it.
That's fair.
Because it is very sort of exploration heavy, which isn't necessarily my bent.
Yeah.
I like sort of being, like having like a driving sort of narrative, like not linear, but like, you know, sort of what you said about The Witcher earlier.
Yeah.
The main story like really pulls you along and keeps you engaged.
It does, it's true.
And so there is a story to Breath of the Wild, but it's much more discovered than a driver.
Yeah, that's true.
And so
when I find myself in the mood for like exploration and just playing around, and I really want to like make sure that when I sit down with it, I have a few hours free, which it's hard to find.
Yeah, that is tough.
Because I want to be able to take my time and enjoy it instead of like sitting down for 20 minutes, finding that I basically just tooled around with trying to climb a rock and then I have to get off.
Yeah.
So that is the reason I have not been playing it recently, but I definitely plan to get back to it.
There's an inherent irony in what you just said, and it's that the Switch was designed to be a mobile platform.
Mm-hmm.
And yet clearly you're not using it that way.
The problem is that the thing that's eating up all my time is work.
Yeah.
And so, yes, I could bring my Switch to work, but I can't necessarily pull it out in the middle of my work day and play around on it.
That is so true. Yeah, that's a good point. Not since I was a grade school teacher have I been able to whip out a Game Boy and actually play behind my desk. Yeah, it's so true.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, that's fair. Did you beat the game?
I've not beat it yet.
Okay. But you do plan to?
I do plan to.
Okay. All right. Well, I guess that's fair. And do you have any other games for the Switch?
Yeah, I've got a bunch, actually. I mentioned last week Super Mario Odyssey, Fire Emblem Warriors.
Right, right.
Splatoon 2, which I haven't had a chance to really sit down with much yet. ARMS I played for a little while. And then a few other miscellaneous ones, Puyo Puyo Tetris.
Okay.
So I've got actually a pretty good collection on the Switch.
Yeah, it sounds like maybe your investment was spread around a little bit.
Yeah, it wasn't just for Breath of the Wild.
A little bit more than mine anyway, because I'm throwing $15 and $20 at various games. But mostly it was the Zelda.
Mm-hmm. I still feel like, though, if Breath of the Wild was the only thing I played on the Switch, it would still probably be worth it.
Oh, yeah, you know, I would have to agree with that, actually.
But the good news is it's not the only game on the Switch that's worth playing. So, Doc, how about you? Have you been playing Breath of the Wild recently?
You know, it's funny. I actually picked it up yesterday and played it for probably about an hour and a half and just kind of got to some of those shrines that are a little closer to Hyrule Castle. And, man, I took a beating from the Guardians, too. Those guys are jerks. But, you know, I'd actually taken about a month and a half break from it. I just kind of fizzled and got bored, and I really didn't care so much about finishing the game. I had everything explored, and I had gotten to the point where I was I love being able to pull up that map and see where you've traveled, the hero's journey, you know, line. You ever done that? You ever actually look? And so I can go, oh, I've never been to that particular spot. And so I would just teleport over there and kind of run around a little bit, see what I'd missed.
Nice.
And I found a couple of shrines that way, because you can turn on your shrine seeking hat or whatever it is that does that. But in all, I'm probably powerful enough to be able to just go in and do the Ganon thing, but I've never enjoyed Zelda for the boss fights. I know that sounds counterintuitive, but
no, I'm with you. Like, and I think I've talked about this on the podcast before. For some people, the fun of Zelda is all about the dungeons and it's all about the boss fights and stuff like that.
Right.
Whereas for me, like, I just really had fun with the world and the exploration, and like, not that I'm like exploration heavy, but like just experiencing the world was always the thing for me. The dungeon always felt like the obstacle I just have to get past to get more of what I'm after.
Well, and even to the point where the shrines, I've really enjoyed the shrines because they were puzzles.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever I get to one of those tests of strength, minor, major, whatever, and I'm like, oh, I gotta go fight the thing. Okay, fine.
Mm-hmm.
And even the most powerful ones now, I can just pretty much take down because I've got the equipment for it or whatever, enough hearts. And it's just like, oh, well, that's a shame. I was really excited when I saw the shrine and I went down there to it, and you know, oh boy, a puzzle.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay, that's fine. So if I have any complaint now, late in the game, it's that there weren't more puzzle shrines. I felt like half of them were, you have proven your worth by making it to this place. And then, you know, maybe a quarter of them were, beat this thing. And either you can or you can't. It's not really, so you either have to like bookmark it and come back to it. But I don't think I ever had to come back to one. Again, to my over-leveling problem. But yeah, I'm completely ready to beat Ganon. I've got all the divine beasts up shooting their lasers at the castle and doing all of that. Zelda's giving me her psychic message where she's like, quick, come save me. And I'm like, But I also had difficulty finding the memories. I know how to do it. It just hasn't been worth my time to do it. And I haven't really found the backstory overly compelling. And so, I mean, I love the world, just that personal backstory. It didn't really speak to me. And so going and saving her, I'm like, that's cool. You've been doing it for 100 years.
Yeah.
You can chill for a while. And I know that when I do, I will set it down and I will be done with it.
Mm-hmm.
And
you just don't want to get to that point.
I don't. I enjoy the game enough to not play it, if that makes sense, to not play it knowing I could pick it up again.
Are you interested in any of the DLC?
Yeah. In fact, I've played through some of the challenges in the DLC. I still intend to go do the Master Sword challenge, but I've only gotten to like level 8 or something, and then you die and start over. And that's not my favorite thing. Mm. Starting from the beginning is not my favorite. So I will, like you say, I will have to be in the right mood to do that.
Gotcha.
And do it all in one stretch.
Mm-hmm. I think that's something that I kind of feel with Breath of the Wild is that that openness and that ability to do things at your own pace and stuff like that is great when you're sort of sitting down to do it and you're like really into the game and you're like mastering stuff and you're learning new stuff, but it's not the best game, at least I've found so far. It's not the best game for playing in chunks.
Yeah.
It's definitely kind of like, let's get the whole experience as close together as possible sort of thing, as opposed to a, let's stretch this out over the course of the year.
Snacking versus binging kind of an idea.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
And I do a lot more snacking gaming recently than binging, unfortunately.
Fair enough. Yeah.
And now, this week's meaty topic of discussion.
So we've talked a little bit before about procedural generation, but this is not, that's not the sort of randomness we're talking about today.
Right. Bad procedurally generated stuff is really just random, but that is totally not what we're talking about.
What we're talking about is the thing that you do in game design where as you're sort of going through kind of like writing the rules, basically, and now this is something that even happens in video games, even if they never explain the rules to you, there's a system behind everything
behind
everything that works in the game. And so when you're designing the system, sometimes the question comes up of, do we want to have this be a chance of happening? Do we want this to be like essentially rolling the dice like you would in a board game or a tabletop RPG right. or something like that?
Well, and if we take ourselves back, you know, here we go. It's 1970 mumble mumble, right? Video games aren't really a thing. We're sitting around a table and we're telling a story, and we want to know whether or not our character, as represented by a character sheet, succeeds at a thing or not. And so our good friend Gary, across the table from us, decides that he's going to roll a die and add his personal modifier to that die, and then, boom, we have either a hit that does or does not work and that kind of a thing. The thing is, that's the exact same system that is in hundreds, if not thousands of games today, even if we don't see it.
It's just transparent, yeah.
Yeah, and obviously—
Or opaque, I should say.
It's opaque, yeah. So it's a lot more obvious in some games, like RPGs especially. We could point to MMORPGs like World of Warcraft and show how you can actually turn that on. You can turn the numbers on. It's fun. I love turning it on because you hit with your sword and you see the little 573 show up, and then that's how much damage you did or whatever. You know, and it's cool to me to see that. But even single player games will let you do that.
And sometimes they're transparent about, like, you know, World of Warcraft will say sometimes like this has a blank percent chance of hitting.
Right.
So you know that every time you swing your sword, it's calculating whether or not you're going to hit with that particular strike.
And it's not really rolling a D20 in that case. What it's doing is it's rolling on a percent to hit table. So you could kind of say that it's rolling on a D100 system if you really wanted to,
generating a random number between 1 and 100.
Right.
And if it's above blank, then
and some systems use percentile dice to that exact measure. And then you've got other games like, well, I'll use a classic example here, Mario. There's not really a weapon in Mario, think of something like the fireball or something, right? If it hits, it's going to kill the thing, right? And you have to hit Bowser exactly this number of times in order for it to hit. Now that we got a little more complicated in later generations, and it was like if you get a headshot, well, that counts as a 5. And if it's a body shot, that's just a 1, right? And things like that. But that's still a set value.
Right.
And so what we're really talking about is something like Fallout, the original Fallout, where you walk in and the fight starts. And if you remember the original Fallout, it went from real-time to turn-based as soon as the fight started. And what I would do is I would save as soon as the fight started. And if it was a completely unfair fight, which Fallout was happy, perfectly happy to let you be in, meaning you are going to die. Mm-hmm. You take even one bullet, you are going to die if you've wandered in somewhere you shouldn't be. And what I would do is I would go in and I would have like a perk that was something to do with a critical hits, or I would always take those kinds of things, right? And so if one of my characters, because you had companion characters, one of the characters, the dog or something like that, died, I would reload. It got down to the point where I would quick save before I did an action, and then I would do the action, and then I would let the computer take its turn. And then if one of my characters had, if something had terrible had happened or one of my characters died, I would reload to that last thing. Mm-hmm. Totally gaming the system. That's how I played the original Fallout, second time I played it, or when I got into a really frustrating situation. Total cheat, complete cheat. But I literally beat the game that way. Because that was long before I discovered the magic of overleveling. Mm-hmm. And actually, one of the reasons why I choose to overlevel now is because I don't like that idea of reloading at the beginning of a boss fight. It breaks my immersion. I would much rather go in super overpowered and be Superman than have to play the fight five or six times.
Right.
So all of that is to simply say that really what I was doing in those moments was I was spending Erthe to reroll. It was a reroll. Mm-hmm. Mechanically, it was a no reset that roll again. No reset that roll again. And if I needed like let's say a 90 percentile, there's a 10% chance that I was going to get a critical hit, but I needed the critical hit. Mm-hmm. I would reset 10 times until I got the critical hit. I don't know why this was fun for me, but you know, I was like 20. So, what are your thoughts on that?
So specifically on...
Well, from a design perspective, mm-hmm. for example, games nowadays, a lot of them don't let you do that. They've stripped out the save mechanic mm-hmm. entirely. We were talking of Witcher. Witcher's interesting because it has an autosave, mm-hmm. but it also has a quick save, but it also has a manual save. Mm-hmm. You can do any of those things at pretty much any time. Every now and then you'll get the pop-up that says you can't do that at this time. Mm-hmm.
My personal preference is I like the autosave systems, mm-hmm. and I like frequent enough autosaves that if I die for some reason, I don't have to go back and replay an hour.
Right. The worst.
But and that comes down to some other kind of like just general... best practices for game design, like don't make a player do something super hard more than once, or
right.
whatever it might be. But all that aside, just like I don't like being it, sort of to your point, you know, you like over leveling because you like just fight the boss once, even if it was a super easy fight, mm-hmm. because it doesn't break the immersion. I really hate being in the mindset of I need to be saving constantly in case I die,
right.
or something like that. And the last time I did that was actually kind of like a retro game at the time. I went back and replayed Jedi Knight 2. For the PC, which is something that I played a lot as a kid, but wasn't super good at because I was younger. And then it's like, hey, I've been through college now and I am good at video games. I'm going to try this again. And it was a cool game. It was a fun game. It was very challenging in certain places. And because it was so challenging, you definitely get used to doing what a lot of people do is basically like mashing the autosave button constantly, which I really, I got used to it, but I really hated having to do that. Mm-hmm. I really prefer the autosaves. But coming back down to the randomization thing, to your point, yes, a lot of games now, especially video games, have sort of taken out that sort of random chance thing. And in fact, now I think that if any game does keep it, it's very explicitly an RPG mm-hmm. Or an RPG derivative, because they're trying to it's kind of like their way of controlling to a certain extent, both like the power of your character. And then, you know, another example that just came to mind is things like loot and stuff like that, like percent chance of drops. Mm-hmm. This is even something they have in Fire Emblem Warriors, where you can sort of like apply different abilities and stuff like that to increase the chances that this sort of loot will drop.
Sure.
So in this case, the randomization is actually a way for them to control the rate at which you acquire things.
Right.
In a way that's variable. Instead of saying it's like every time you kill this specific enemy, this is going to happen. It's just like every time you kill a type of enemy, there's this percent chance that something's going to drop. And usually that percentage is low enough that it's going to be
It's not going to like, you're not going to get some freak thing where you get like five things in a row because it just happened to like roll the natural 25 right. times in a row. Well, because it's usually,
you could, but
it's not very likely to happen.
Astronomically low that you would do that. Yeah.
Which raises another interesting question, actually, that I've heard some, like one, I forget who it was that said this, but I saw somebody on Twitter, I think it was, saying that when you're talking about randomness, do you want it to be truly random or do you want it to be distributed?
Right.
Basically, like if you want to compare it, there was a really interesting analog example I was shown when I was in grad school where you take a deck of cards
right,
and you split up, sweets. Mm-hmm. And so you know that there's a 1 in 12 chance that this thing is going to be here, but you split them up, shuffle them randomly, and then stack them a certain way.
Right.
So you know that if you draw that thing, there's like a 1 in 12 chance that the next one's going to be the same thing.
Right.
Because you know that it's there's only one per however many cards.
Mm-hmm.
And so that sort of spaces it out more believably. And if you do happen to get two things in a row, then you can be very confident that you're not going to get another one of those for at least 11 turns.
That's actually a core mechanic in Forbidden Island and Forbidden Desert.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever you set up the deck, it's very important that you pull those elements out. Another game that I would say that does that is Pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
Although with a lot of the legacy stuff with Pandemic, some of that changes.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think that that's a super important, maybe even critically important comparison.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to roll a die where the chance of any particular face of that die coming up is equal,
mm-hmm.
what we call linear probability, or do you want a deck of cards where the chances of a specific card coming up is a one in however high the card deck is.
Mm-hmm. Now, but then not again for...
Yeah, not until you've shuffled.
Mm-hmm.
And there might be a mechanic for shuffling. Mm-hmm. Again, I'll point to Pandemic. Whenever certain things happen, you shuffle the deck
mm-hmm.
and then set it back up on top of itself. So like that, you shuffle the discard and put it on top of the deck. So you go through, you burn through all the stuff that you've already seen before
mm-hmm.
so that the disease will break out where it already has been. And it's a beautiful solution mm-hmm. to make it feel, well, to use exactly the right word, organic,
mm-hmm.
As opposed to literally being random. One of my least favorite games, probably my least favorite game of all ever mm-hmm. board game is Arkham. The Arkham Horror mm-hmm. is the name of it. Because everything is so random. It's here's the deck of cards. The monsters that come out are going to be random. The stuff they do is going to be random. Everything is random, 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 mm-hmm. random. And again, it's distributed.
Mm-hmm.
You're not rolling dice in that way. You're not rolling on a table. But I almost kind of wish you were, or that there was some other slightly more curated or designed in element of that. And mm-hmm. the reason I do not like that game, it's not because of the fight mechanics. It's not because of the overwhelming odds. It's not because of that. It's because if you pull the wrong card on turn three, the game's over.
Mm-hmm.
And so I honestly look at it as Candyland. This is the classic game designer example. Candyland has a predetermined outcome from the beginning of the game whenever you start.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of my challenges as a professor to a game design student, an early challenge, is fix Candyland.
Mm-hmm.
What is your solution to fix Candyland? For what it's worth, my personal solution for fixing Candyland is take three cards and you choose – you. Reintroduce choice
mm-hmm.
back into that. And that way you don't have to change anything about the way the game is sold, distributed. Mm-hmm. You go pick up your copy at Walmart
mm-hmm.
and you take it home and you play it with your 3-year-old, which I have one. So this is easy. And it's, you just adjust that rule slightly
mm-hmm.
so that, oh, which card would strategically make the most sense for me to do right now. And then you're not making it hard. It's still on a 3-year-old's level of comprehension.
Mm-hmm.
But takes away that pre-programmed outcome from the beginning of the game.
Mm-hmm. And I think that hits on
probably like the biggest single takeaway, if there is one, and this is not to close the discussion,
no,
but to say that, you know, player choice is a super important thing in games.
Yes.
Player skill specifically, and this is something that I've talked many, many times before about, the theory of fun for game design, mm-hmm. by Raph Koster. And one of the things he talks about one of the things he talks about, and other game designers talk about this too, he's not the only one, the importance of skill in a game.
Yes.
A game needs to require player skill, and it doesn't matter if the skill is, like, depending on the game, it might be something mechanical. Mm-hmm. Do I have the dexterity to be able to do this properly?
Yes.
Or strategic. It could be, do I have the right decision making?
Well, and that gets into player skill versus character skill.
Yeah.
But mm-hmm. that's a whole separate thing.
Mm-hmm. And so if you have a game with too much randomization, what tends to be happening is you're adding more and more chances for the player's skill to be either canceled out,
yeah.
or to be invalidated,
yeah.
or even just removed entirely. There was actually, speaking of, you know, school, one of my grad classes, we had an assignment to make a board game, basically, as a theme.
Of course.
And the theme that I did for this one is, I called it Welcome to College, because I think we're supposed to do something about a thing we're familiar with, if I remember correctly. I could be wrong. And so the core concept around the game was that, like, that sort of phrase you hear, that, like, you can have three things, you know, a social life, good grades, or sleep. you know, pick two.
Pick two.
Yeah. And so that's basically what you do each turn, is you decide to either, like, rest and recharge,
mm-hmm.
or, you know, study, or go out and be social and to, like, have a life.
Right.
I'm
still not caught up on sleep.
And so everything about, and the objective of the game is to finish the game with the highest score grade wise.
Right.
And so you're trying to balance your rest and all this stuff. And what will happen is, if you're not rested enough, like if you do nothing but study, you're going to suffer because you're going to have penalties based mm-hmm. on being tired mm-hmm. and stuff like that. And so I had, like, this really interesting system where basically what would happen is you study and stuff like that to increase the probability that you're going to, pass your test or do your assignment well, that sort of thing. But it wasn't guaranteed. And so one of the biggest criticisms that I got from people, and it wasn't, like, egregious, it wasn't as bad as it could have been,
mm-hmm.
but the biggest criticism I got was that there was too much randomization. Too much came down to that dice roll to see whether or not you succeeded. And the whole point of it was that I wanted to make sure that, without guaranteeing a good grade,
mm-hmm.
Because there, I was kind of comparing it to the idea that you sit down for a test that you think you're prepared for, but then it turns out you're not.
Right.
So what are the chances of that happening? Rather than just saying, you study hard enough, you will succeed. It's like, because that's not how life works.
Yeah.
So, but at the same time, from a game design perspective, I might have had too much randomization because, you know, you come down to that dice roll, and even though you've got these modifiers based on what you studied and how,
right,
and all these other different things, there's still a chance that, like, you did everything you could have to prepare, and then you just bombed the test.
Yeah.
Because you just happened
you
to roll
studied the wrong chapter.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no. And, you know, part of that, too, is I was working into the system things where I know that if you do X, Y, and Z, you're going to have a minimum of this, mm-hmm. which is not as bad as the lowest possible thing you can do, that sort of thing.
Well, and I guess there would be a way to, and I don't know the system because I didn't mm-hmm. play that game, but there would be a way to get your bonus, your modifier, mm-hmm. essentially, up so high that you're really minimizing the mm-hmm. chances that you would.
And that was the idea. Yeah.
I could see that being completely valid. Mm-hmm. And all the while your social life is suffering, I mm-hmm. assume.
Yeah. I'd have to go back and look at the rules, but, yeah. But yeah, and then there's also stuff where, like, for example, you could take your time to help someone else study. Part of the idea too is that your character, you're a different major basically.
Yeah.
And your major is basically your class.
Oh,
so
cool.
If you were an art major, you're going to be really good at art stuff, but not so good at science.
Oh, art majors don't have to study. What are you talking about?
Right.
Says the former art major.
We know very well that you do a lot of work in art class.
Yeah, very true. Very, very true.
And so without spending too much time on that particular game,
uh-huh.
Just kind of like that's one of the things that came down to. And also there's the consideration, because that was a board game, all the rolling you had to do and all the other sort of like moving pieces around
right.
is a pace consideration.
Yeah.
And so it could slow the game down as well to have all these times when you're doing the randomization,
yes.
however it is that you handle
oh,
it.
Oh, yes. Well, you know, that as tempted as I am to talk at this point about Kickstarter stretch goal fatigue, mm-hmm. I won't. I'm going to set that aside and instead say this very, very natural transition into German games
mm-hmm.
or Euro games, mm-hmm. both being pretty exchangeable terms mm-hmm. there. But what it means is, by definition, what it means is a class of board game with no dice,
mm-hmm.
with no random element. And it's argued as to exactly how far that goes. Mm-hmm. Like if there's a deck of cards, oh, that's a random element. Mm-hmm. No, really what it's saying is that a game where you roll 2d6 and then move the thief, mm-hmm. that's not technically a Euro game. Mm-hmm. I think you know which game I'm talking about there. whereas if you have, let's say, 6 action points, that is classically Euro game. Mm-hmm. Because what it means is you look on a little table and it costs, okay, so it's going to cost me 2 action points to buy a new tile and place it on the board. It's going to cost me 1 action point per space I move on the board. Mm-hmm. And it's going to, and that kind of a thing. And some of the classics that are that way, I would point to like Tikal was a great game that worked and operated that way. That said, I think that the idea of it like a worker placement game or that kind of a thing, a lot of those have had a revival mm-hmm. lately. And we can't even call them Euro games anymore because they're not being made in Europe. they're full on, you know, American or Canadian. I love the French Canadian ones. They have this cool aesthetic. and a lot of those now are just completely doing away with the random element. Mm-hmm. And I love that because it's pure strategy, mm-hmm. pure strategy. So, that said, then, let's bring it back into a video game space. What should be the metric for the decision point for not having a random element in our video game?
And I think that's going to come down a lot to the type of game that it is. Again, if we operate under the assumption, I think it's a good assumption to operate under, that player skill is required at some level. If you get to the point where we're saying World of Warcraft, where you're not requiring player skill to, and people can make arguments that like the timing of when you use a spell or something like that, or the way you attack or whatever.
I'm not going to have that argument. Is
important. But just let's just say for a second that what we're talking about is like the mechanical skill of, can I swing my sword well enough? That's not the question. The question is, when do I right click on the person to start my auto attack?
Or even, can I build a macro mm-hmm. that is going to defeat the boss? Mm-hmm.
And so
that's a different kind of skill set.
And so the skill in WoW is managing your resources, managing, like, say, if you're a spellcaster, your mana and that sort of thing.
Correct.
Knowing which spells heals, to use heals. When. managing cooldowns, that sort of thing. That's where the player skill comes in. Not in whether or not when I press my button, am I... And you could even argue that, yes, there is range, but it's very generous range. Like, I can actually, like, my sword animation won't physically hit someone, and yeah. it will still hit them.
Yeah.
I just have to be close enough to use my melee attack. So
that's very, very true.
It's not like a beat-em-up where I press, you know, like, X with the right timing and mm-hmm. the right range to be able to hit an opponent. It is, do I press the button at a right time strategically? So my player skill is about my strategy, not about my action gameplay.
Or you look at something like the Shadow of Mordor series or even the Assassin's Creed series, and there's hundreds of animations, of fight animations that go into that, and they look beautifully executed, mm-hmm. even whenever they are themselves random in terms of, okay, we haven't seen this particular animation for a while, finishing move, and it's not about player skill that activates the finishing move, mm-hmm. but it's almost like you're looking down on your character doing a cool thing mm-hmm. because you did a cool thing. What did you really do? Well, you jumped down from high above and you hit the button to stealth kill. Mm-hmm. But that animation that you get to see is not the same animation over and over mm-hmm. and over and over. There's dozens of them.
Yeah.
And it gives you a neat one.
So sort of answer the question another way, perhaps. And this is, again, going back to the tabletop RPG thing.
Oh, yeah.
When should we roll dice? When it is important to the outcome. Like when the outcome's in doubt, one, but also when it's meaningful that the outcome be in doubt.
Yeah,
good point. You have to think about what you're randomizing and why. And so in World of Warcraft, I mean, there are a lot of moves that, like, if you press the thing and they're in range, it's going to hit unless they have a counter for it. Mm-hmm. There actually isn't that much that's random. To whatever extent, but maybe there's things like, you know, a range of damage or something like that.
Sure, yeah.
And so randomizing in cases like, you know, Shadow of War and Assassin's Creed and stuff like that is something that's kind of meant to keep the game feeling fresh because it's not the same thing over and over again.
You're talking about the animations.
Yeah, the animations. Yeah. Or even like, you know, there is a chance that on this given, like, you play through the thing a couple of times. Or maybe like the same sort of like repeating mission or whatever the case mm-hmm. might be. We'll randomize, like, we know there are going to be enemies. Maybe we'll randomize the number of enemies or something like
that. Sure, yeah.
Or we'll change Like just like little things that like aren't even necessarily like directly involved with the player action. This are changing the experience. This kind of goes a little bit into the procedural generation and stuff like
right,
that.
Right. Yeah.
Where it's all about mixing things up using the randomization. Mm-hmm. But when you're talking about using randomization as a mechanic or as part of a system, that's when you have to start getting into, am I using this meaningfully?
Yeah.
And is there a reason that, what is the reason, I guess, that you're using the randomization
right.
and not making it purely, I press the button, this thing happens?
I would think about Diablo and the way it uses, quote unquote, procedural generation mm-hmm. for its maps. Yet there's huge chunks of that which are curated. Mm-hmm. It's just about fitting the pieces of the puzzle together. Well, very much like it's like a board game, actually. The version 2.0 of Mansions of Madness, we talked about this last year when it came out, does a brilliant job of taking the pieces that you tell it you have mm-hmm. and then generating from a set of maps so that even if you've played the same scenario again, you won't know what the map is.
Right.
It's wonderful.
Yeah. You can't just like memorize it. And
right.
It prevents one of the things that I don't like about certain retro games and even some modern games that are retro likes. The idea of what I kind of call performing the game, which is to say that I've just been through it enough times that I remember what needs to happen when, and I just get really good at doing it a specific way.
Yeah. I can hear Jim like screaming now.
But I mean, that's, you know, if that's the sort of game you're into, that's the sort of challenge. Like basically you need to be able to, the player's skill is memorizing all this stuff and then being able to execute it properly. That's great.
I do not have that skill.
I just don't find that fun personally.
I agree with that. But those who do find that fun, I can see why they mm-hmm. find that fun, if that makes any sense, mm-hmm. because that is an incredibly impressive feat mm-hmm. whenever you can pull it off. You know, that's funny. That ties into you were talking about procedural versus random. Mm-hmm. That ties into a thing that Shadow of War has done. Now, I have not played it, so I can't speak for this personally, mm-hmm. but if you use the same attack over and over and over again mm-hmm. against a specific character, orc character, or enemy character, they will learn it mm-hmm. and they will anticipate it
and then counter the strategy.
They will counter it, and you have to do something different.
Mm-hmm. And they're transparent about it too. They'll even say, "Hey, they learned this, and the thing they just did is counter it." And so it's letting you, the player, know, "Oh crap, I need to not use this strategy over and over again."
And you know what? That itself, to me, if you'd asked me a couple of years ago, I'd have been like, oh, that's terrible design. Why would you put that up there like that? But then no, because a truly masterful swordsman would understand what had just happened. Mm-hmm. And I am not a master swordsman. And not only that, but I am separated from that character in enough of I literally am having mm-hmm. an out-of-body experience that I need the heads-up display that tells me that.
What it also does, too, is it tells you why it is that this attack that has always worked for me suddenly is getting blocked.
Suddenly is failing, yeah.
And now it feels like, oh, this is unfair. The game is just blocking this attack. Well, it's telling you it's because they learned your pattern.
Yeah, that's true. That's a very good point. So that technically is not random. Mm-hmm. In fact, it's kind of in kind of a weird way, it's telling you yourself, the player, mm-hmm. you need to be more random. Mm-hmm. You need to strategically, I'm about to use kind of an oxymoron mm-hmm. here. You need to use strategic randomness. Mm-hmm. Something that can't be anticipated. Of course,
break the pattern.
But then I wonder, you know, since it still is a system, can you intentionally teach it a thing so that it expects, oh, you're going to do this thing. You're going to do this thing. You're going to do this thing. And then you do another thing.
I think that's great.
Is that the point or is that gaming it? I don't know. That takes us into weird territory.
Yeah. There. And it's one of those things where it's like, it's a subtle adjustment to an existing system that then changes the system so much that it's almost a system of its own.
Yeah. It's a different paradigm.
Now this game is about strategies and counter strategies.
Yeah.
And less about, hitting this attack button a bunch of times.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And so, and like, you know, let's get not to dwell on that example too much. But like the, you have to keep in mind when you're designing systems, and that one's a good example uh-huh. of what is the player trying to learn? What are they trying to do? What is the skill involved? And, you know, if we want to take that example, would there be a space somewhere in that particular subsystem where randomness would fit in? I would say not, because that one is all about the player makes the choice mm-hmm. and that choice is going to be either countered or it's going to pay off because they did the one of the several right things that they could have done there.
Very well said.
So again, we're kind of coming back to the importance of player skill and choice and consequence. And that's what games are all about. Ultimately,
yeah.
You have a goal that you're trying to achieve. There are rules that basically define how it is that you will fail, how it is you're allowed to succeed at it. And it's about mastering the systems in order to be able to achieve that goal.
Mm-hmm.
And when randomness gets in the way of that is when it starts to become a problem.
Yeah.
But when randomness helps to make things more interesting, or when, again, part of the strategy is that, like, I'm going to do everything I can to improve my chances here because I know that this is not a sure thing, but I can account for that and I can prepare for it. It's all about the player understanding what it is they can and can't do, what it is they're able to control and not control.
Yeah.
And then making choices based on that.
Well, and when you really get down to it, if you talk about it in terms of the 10,000 hours of expertise,
mm-hmm.
okay, and I would say Jane McGonigal has a lot to say about that. So if you're really interested in that topic, she's a good place to start. But this idea of the 10,000 hours of expertise, we as gamers have that, most of us.
Mm-hmm.
And many of us have frighteningly more than that. If we've played 10 games or more, we have probably, you know, we're getting close to it, mm-hmm. which is scary. That said, I should say 100 games. I did my math wrong there. If we have 100 games or more, if we've played 100 games or more, we're probably getting pretty close to it. So what is interesting is that if you're talking about randomness in the terms of a dice roll, as in percentage you might fail, what you're really talking about here is we want to, from a simulationist standpoint, bring in a simulation model of the percentage chance of failure for an expert. So what I mean is I'm a master swordsman within the context of the fantasy of being a character, but I'm a really, really good one. So most of my strikes hit. Well, what's most? 8 out of 10. Mm-hmm.
And then the random chance, like this is something that drives me nuts sometimes in certain RPGs, when I'm a master swordsman and I'm going up against random scrub.
Uh-huh.
And my chance of success is 99 out of 100.
Right.
But for some reason, I rolled that 1 out of 100 chance and I lose the fight because.
Because, yeah.
But when, like, really. And yes, maybe there's like some freak accident where like someone gets a lucky shot or something like that, or I make a mistake or whatever the case may be. And if you're a good narrativist, you can react to that appropriately.
Mm-hmm.
So you can make up for it. But it just is a general rule. It drives me nuts in RPGs when, especially when like my job is to be the one that does a thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can't do the thing because I failed because I had a percent chance of failing.
Right.
And now we're just stuck.
Right.
I wish more systems, and some do this to be fair, more systems would just like let it be you do the thing and you succeed because that is what you do.
Right.
But then they counter that with like, you know, pros and cons. And that's the other thing too about, you know, randomization or the lack thereof
mm-hmm.
brings you into what's the advantage and disadvantage of a certain strategy. You know, like the sort of cost benefit analysis, if
right,
you will.
Right. Well, you know, I'm reminded of one of the great classic tabletop games of all time, Warhammer and or Warhammer 40K. And through 5+ editions of that, basically what you had to do, regardless of the particulars of the unit or what the scenario was or anything like that, was first of all, you took the stats of the thing you were rolling for. In other words, let's call him an orc shooter, right? And what you'd do is you would roll to hit based on his ballistic skill. Then you would roll to wound based on the particular weapon itself
mm-hmm.
Versus the toughness of the thing you were trying to hit.
Mm-hmm.
And then the thing you were trying to hit, assuming that you wounded, would then try to stave off with the armor. And this was a really complex way of there being 3 opportunities to fail
mm-hmm.
based on the various stats. And so you'd get these orcs out there. I would field like 100 orcs standard, right? A lot of times I would do that. And they were super cheap units, but they couldn't hit for anything. And so you'd have to get them halfway across the you know, across the map. And then half of them would be dead by that point because ordnance was coming at me and then, and all these things. And by the time they got there, I might or might not win. And it was a war of attrition every single time. And a smart space marine is not going to charge an orc. They're going to let them come. So that became the scenario every single time is, can I get to the space marines and actually cut through their tank and take them out before they demolish my lines and they run away?
And that's an interesting case of the system and the mechanics informing the meta, basically.
Exactly.
I'm sure they designed that around, they designed that probably at least to some extent intentionally to get a certain type of gameplay.
Very much so.
They are expecting the scenario to be very frequently that the orcs charge and the space marines mow them down.
That's exactly right. Well, and that's what's interesting about sort of, let's call it the Age of Sigmar design that has come lately, both for the fantasy and now apparently for 40K as well, if the rumors are to be believed. And it's that what you've got is a much simpler and fewer chances to fail in that regard. It's all kind of abstracted together and out. And it's still Warhammer at its core, and it still feels like all these other, you know, iterations that it has been. But it's getting us away from the simulationist aspect of this particular bullet is represented by this particular die.
Right.
And now this die represents your armor. And it,
well, what's interesting is even the most simulationist of games is still abstracting the reality.
Of course it is.
Because when you get down to it, there is no such thing as randomness.
No.
Everything has cause and effect.
Right.
This is just physical scientific fact. And so if we wanted to, we could go through and talk about the gun, when the trigger was pulled, was pointed in this direction. Wind was this, air resistance was this, go on and on and on. The bullet is going to hit this point at this time.
You're talking about Mech Warrior.
Right. And then, like, you know, if it hits the target, because it was aimed at the target, and the target was in the trajectory, it's going to hit this part of the body. It's going to do exactly this much damage. It's going to kill them or wound them, as the case might be, or it's going to kill them later. All this stuff is very deterministic, but we abstract it because we don't have the time to sit down and do advanced physics for every gunshot.
Well, and I think there's something to be said for that as a design principle, especially for the modern gamer who has video games, which can literally do all of that for us. And still keep it in sort of real time.
And that's why shooters, for example, it's all about aiming. And you learn the systems of like how your guns behave in this space. It's all about where you're pointing, where everyone's positioned, how they're moving, et cetera. There is no chance to hit until you get to, you know, Fallout, because they're trying to shoehorn RPG elements into the action game, which that one's, it's always been a little bit tricky. I've always played it only in VATS because I want to have more control over my random chance and not just like, why am I shooting at this guy for 20 seconds with the gun that should be hitting them and not hitting them?
It's because of blowback. I like that you went there because that's a great way to close this out and parallel sort of bookend my first example, which was from Fallout 1. In the most recent Fallout, I did not feel compelled to reload based on any fight mechanic at all. If I ran out of bullets, oh no. If I got shot, oh no. If I used up some of my materials, oh no. And even the companions can't die. They sort of curl up in the corner and cry until the fight is over. But what I would reload for sometimes is whenever that option for a dialogue option happened, and it's a percentage chance of success on the dialogue option, and I've poured points into boosting that stat and then failed anyway. Because from a mechanical standpoint, my whole point was, okay, game,
I want to be a good talker, and
I want this to succeed. And when it doesn't, and the firefight breaks out, I'm like, oh, dang it. And so I'll just reload up in the last second.
And so really what it should be is that, like, if you're a skilled enough talker, you're able to recognize, here's the right thing to say to disarm the situation.
Correct.
And if it was the right thing to say, it will be disarmed. If it wasn't, then it won't.
Right.
But when that same thing, it's like, hey, let's talk about this. Like, let's just say that's the line. It's not a percent chance that person is or isn't going to react to it that way. It might seem that way from our perspective, because it's like, when I use this line, about 50% of the time people react a certain way, but that person you're speaking to is going to react a particular way.
Yeah. I would see it almost as an unlockable, mm-hmm. is that I unlocked the tier of successful responses, mm-hmm. Or something like that.
Or now, even
that
you,
might be a different game than Fallout, though.
Or you unlock the response, but it just so happens, and it doesn't tell you there's a percent chance it's going to work. It just is or isn't going to work on this character, and they know that going into it. Like, yeah, behind the scenes, they know. Behind the scenes, they know that this character isn't going to respond well to the diplomatic option. Mm-hmm. But you have the diplomatic option because you have the skill for it.
You know, I kind of wish Jim was here for this conversation because one of the reasons he's never played the new Fallout is because he dislikes only having four dialogue options so much. Mm-hmm. But honestly, the way that it is treed and the way that it breaks out, there are options which replace and sort of the... like, for example, there's always an option that's a little bit sarcastic. It's mm-hmm. the sarcastic option. And some characters respond really well to the sarcastic option, and some will respond very badly to the sarcastic option. And the way that game is done, it will shut down conversation with an individual forever mm-hmm. if you're too sarcastic with them or, you know, too serious with them or whatever. And they're just like, I don't like you, mm-hmm. and I'm not going to have more conversations with you.
That's actually a system I worked into the game that we were talking about last week with Kara.
Your Nessus project.
I had basically, like, they had an opinion of you, and if you got it too low, they would just stop talking to you.
Right, which made perfect sense for that game, actually. Mm-hmm. So I guess ultimately what it comes down to for me is exactly what you said. Is there a good enough reason to randomize this? Mm-hmm. And if there is a good enough reason to randomize it, then is it still fun if you fail? Mm-hmm. Can you fail forward? Mm-hmm. And failing forward is a huge part of our design aesthetic. You know, because I mean, we're Doc and Kruger sitting here, so we can talk in terms of Doc and Kruger. You know, what we design whenever failure is an option. Failure is never an option. But when failure is an option, we fail forward, mm-hmm. Narratively, I would say.
We make it meaningful. It's not not just like, oh, you didn't open the door, bummer. Yeah. We make not opening the door turn into something.
Yeah. And it's not out of a lack of understanding that early RPGs, you could just explode and die without any meaning whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And that was part of the fun of those systems. Mm-hmm. Those just aren't the types of systems we design.
Right.
So that's not a part of our core philosophy.
Mm-hmm. We design for story, not for the action, so
exactly
to speak.
Yeah, exactly.
And like, our stories can have action, but what we're trying to do is create a narrative. And so if the narrative stops because we failed to pick that lock, that's a problem.
Exactly. And that is a huge problem if there's only one door and you need that. And then, I mean, I've been in campaigns, not lately, which is a great thing, but I've been in campaigns before where, okay, roll for the thing, and then if the roll is not what the GM had in mind, the GM finds another way to just make it happen anyway. Mm-hmm. Well, then that role was meaningless.
Right. Right.
So why did I have to roll? Mm-hmm. And that, I think, partly falls on the GM, but it also partly falls on the system. Mm-hmm. A good system is going to accommodate that in both a tabletop and also a digital environment. Mm-hmm.
And so, say, for example, you know, in D&D, when I failed to pick the lock to open the chest, well, not opening the chest isn't going to mean the game's over. It just means that I don't get that bonus treasure inside.
Right, exactly right.
But that's very different from we need – the story requires that we get into this room. We can't open the door. Now what? Mm-hmm. And this partially comes down to, like, how good are you as a GM sort of reacting to this? Okay, they can't get into the door. That means that a guard's going to come up and they're going to be carried off. And now this next chapter of the story is trying to escape from a cell or something like
that. And I could see if you're talking in terms of, we need to get through the door and there's a key in that chest, mm-hmm. Maybe you could smash open the chest. Mm-hmm. But if you do, you made noise and the ogre in the next room mm-hmm. comes in.
Choice and consequence.
And now you have to fight him. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, there's lots of different ways that you could go with it.
Yep.
Depending on how open your story is. Great example. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Fantastic example. Doors before keys. That's a whole nother thing. But, I really think that there's so much to be learned from analog games, from tabletop games, mm-hmm. not just storytelling tabletop games, but I mean board games, mm-hmm. card games, dice games, that someone who is making video games should actively be playing board games mm-hmm. as broadly just defined, so that they can understand a function of analog probability.
Because ultimately what it comes down to is it's still the same sort of system design. Yes. It's just done by different means.
It absolutely is.
And that's exactly why, you know, when I went through my undergrad and my graduate in game studies, game design classes started us off with board games.
Yep.
Because they're much easier to make than computer games, much less complex, but still gets us thinking along those lines of what are my rules? Why are my rules this way? What are the implications?
Exactly. Right.
And thinking through all of that to get a holistic game that is what you want it to be.
Exactly right. Yeah, I think that we're in a very strange time right now, game design wise. And I don't want to be the one who predicts that the bubble's going to burst, but I have said some rather mean things about designers who are on Kickstarter and just, you know, release all the expansions at once and that kind of thing. But I think that there's something to be said for balancing well, testing well, making sure that there's not a fundamental flaw in your game somewhere. Mm-hmm. And we play a lot of games. I mean, I play approximately 8 to 10 hours of board games a week, average. And so you start talking to me about games, and I can tell you what some of the flaws are, because our group, which is a pretty good big group, has really done an extensive study on these by playing them. And we now have stuff on our list that we won't play anymore because we've figured out how to break them. And there's a few where you just play them a certain way with a certain strategy, you're going to win every single time because the game fundamentally is not balanced.
Mm-hmm. As a dominant strategy. Right. And that goes into game theory, which is a totally different discussion.
It's a totally different thing. Yeah. And what's funny is in a video game environment where you've got thousands of people throwing themselves at this game mechanic every single hour, it becomes very apparent in a place like World of Warcraft, which class is dominant, mm-hmm. which one is not, what's balanced, what's not. And so, you know, companies like Blizz have a nightmare scenario where they're trying to constantly balance, rebalance, overbalance, overcompensate, and that kind of a thing. With a board game environment, you know, you got 3 or 4 hours to play this game, and then so-and-so wins, and it's like, that felt a little imbalanced. I don't know. We need to play again. Okay, let's play this board game for 1,000 more hours and find that out. Mm-hmm. It's just not going to happen. Mm-hmm. So in a way, it's almost a part of the tabletop experience to understand, you know what? There's probably some things in this that are a little imbalanced. Mm-hmm. That's okay, because we're not digitizing it. Mm-hmm. And yet, we find some of these games, the board games, that do make their way over into a mobile space, mm-hmm. Over into like an iPad space. And so one of my all-time favorite games is Carcassonne. Mm-hmm. I've played thousands of hours of Carcassonne digitally because my wife and I, especially, we love to play it on iPad. And so if one of us is out of town or something, we can still play a board game. Mm-hmm. We can watch TV and play the board game. We don't have to get out the 1,000 tiles that it takes to play the full, you know, but also Small World is one of our favorites, and I have that one. And then there's some sort of classic games that are hard to come by anymore, and you can play them by those. And it's really interesting whenever you play a game over and over and over and over again digitally, you almost start to treat it differently. You spot the flaws, if you will, in it. And I'm not picking on any of those games specifically. They're actually some of my favorites. But I think it's important to understand what random really is, mm-hmm. and what it means and what it's used for, and especially a simulationist. Mm-hmm. What you said about it being abstract is super profound, mm-hmm. super profound and correct.
Why, thank you.
Yeah.
And I think too that, like, you know, it might come across like, you know, we're saying that randomness is a bad thing. It's not inherently. And actually there's some games where like that random chance, I actually really enjoy that aspect of the game.
I agree.
Any gambling game is going to have something about probability and randomization.
Of course.
And so sometimes, like, if the roll of the dice is basically I'm lowering my chances by taking a riskier move that's going to have a higher reward, mm-hmm. then that's just a gamble that I'm making, and I go into it knowing that.
Yeah.
And then sometimes you're, like, pleasantly surprised, being like, oh, man, this thing that should have been impossible, I managed to pull off, and that's awesome. Like, you feel really gratified for taking that chance, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, randomness definitely has its place.
I agree.
It's just a matter of thinking through, again, when and how you're using it.
Yeah, and understanding especially with like a deck mechanic, understanding mm-hmm. what the deck is and realizing what it is you're gambling against will change a game also. I'm a big fan of the Euro Rails series, which is the sort of crayon train games. Mm-hmm. You break out the board, you draw on the board with the crayon and make your rails. Well, there's an old one that has been reprinted lately, and it is Iron Dragon, and it is fantasy, and you actually have a foreman, which is great, because then you have a special ability that comes with your form. If you're a dwarf, you can go through mountains with just one gold. Hmm. If you're like an elf or a half-elf, you can go through forests with just one gold and, yeah. and that kind of a thing, instead of it costing two or like it would normally. But the great thing about that particular game and its whole series, just the whole series of them, is the deck. As you pull for a new mission, there's a chance there's going to be an event, and they are all terrible. Bridges will wash out. Desert storms will happen. There will be these massive things. There's ships in that one. You can actually put your train on a ship and sail across the ocean, which is great for Iron Dragon. But then there's like storms that will come. Mm-hmm. And
this is kind of like a pandemic, where part of the game too is knowing that bad things are going to happen, but you don't know when.
Right.
Or exactly what in which, or what's going to happen in which order. And so it's about kind of reacting to the situation, planning as best you can, but knowing that you can't predict on turn five, this thing's going to happen. We need to be ready for
exactly
it.
Exactly right. And so I think, as an important design element, understanding that if you create new content, let's call them expansion content, and in your expansions you add new cards, that you're increasing the size of the deck. And so if there's any kind of a deck milling mechanic, and I say that a little bit derisively, but I don't really mean it that way. I mean, if a fundamental part of the game is search the room, find better stuff, but the better stuff has been diluted so much by some other expansion, you really need to check that. And there may need to be a very clear distinction of, don't combine the decks, guys. Use this deck instead. Mm-hmm. Never shuffle the 300 cards and make a deck out of that. Instead, always stick with either deck A, deck B, or deck C. And that's a completely different sort of design philosophy that I don't see much. Zombicide comes to mind, actually, for that one. If you try to mill the deck in Zombicide looking for that dragon bile, you can blow your chances. You can just waste a game, depending on the scenario. Gotcha. Which, it's not as fun whenever you've spent 5 hours playing and you've milled the deck for a thing and then everybody loses.
Yep.
And especially in a co-op game.
Well, this is a massive topic that I'm sure we could keep talking about for a lot longer, but I think we're running low on time, unfortunately. Indeed. So thank you, Backward Compatible listeners, for joining us for episode number 114 of the podcast, our discussion on randomization and game design. And as we've said a few times before, we are trying to grow the show. So any way that you can support us in that way, we are ad-free and we don't really have an advertising budget to put ourselves out there. So we're counting on you loyal listeners to help us spread the word. So share us with any friends that you think might be interested. Maybe retweet us, share our posts on Facebook, et cetera, like, comment, subscribe. I always feel weird asking this, but we really do need the help. And also, we want you to get involved with the show, so please feel free to email us at inbox@backward-compatible.com. You can reply to anything that we've said in the show, maybe say something that you really wish that we had talked about when something came up but we just didn't go there. Any topic requests, we're happy to field. And even if you just had like kind of a quick question, we have an inbox segment that we'll do, and we'll sort of talk for 5 to 15 minutes, give or take, on just responding to any questions that you guys might happen to have. So we'd love for your support in getting us out there, and also to get more involved with the show.
Word.
Well, thanks again for joining us. I'm Chris.
I'm Doc.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to write into the show, because dialogue makes everyone better. If you want to comment on this episode, ask a question, share some info, voice an opinion, or request a topic, send an email to inbox@backward-compatible.com, and we may feature you on a future episode of the podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible. Backward Compatible.